Hello, everyone. Welcome to The Net Online. Thank you guys so much for joining us. We're going to kick things off, as we always do, with a short video clip that will correspond with our message today. Be sure to like and subscribe so we can give you future alerts for when we post messages, and drop a comment below. And thank you guys so much for joining us.
He's not my own, not of my flesh, not of my bone. Still, Father, let this baby be the son of my love. Father, show Son of God. Lord, for all my life I've been a simple carpenter. How can I raise a king? How can I raise a king? He looks so small, his face and hands so fair. And when he cries, the sun just seems to disappear. And when he laughs, it shines again. How could it be? Father, show me Son of God. Lord, for all my life I've been a simple carpenter. How can I raise a king? How can I raise a king?
All right, so that song, you may have, I'm sure, heard it before. It's called Joseph's Song by Michael Card. It's interesting because most songs, obviously, are about Jesus. As far as Christmas songs and most stories focus on Mary and on Jesus. But today we're going to look at Joseph. And I want us to look at the text, and the title is The Forgotten Hero, really. And Joseph is an amazing man. You think, well, I don't know that we know that much about him. But it's amazing when you kind of begin to piece it together how much we really can know about Joseph. So we're going to read through Luke chapter 1, verses 26 to 33. In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town of Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favored. The Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end." So throughout the Old Testament, whenever the phrase an everlasting kingdom was used, it's referring to a messianic kingdom, that Messiah would one day come and his kingdom would be established forever. So here is, of course, a lot of that was focusing on Mary also, but it's also focusing on Joseph. So here is Joseph minding his own business. He's got great plans. He is going to be married to this young lady named Mary, and they're already betrothed, so there's a commitment, a high commitment level already here. So Joseph is minding his own business and suddenly finds himself in the middle of one of the most scandalous events in all of history, ever. So, and I'm kind of thinking, put yourself in his place, what would your reaction have been? So again, most Christmas stories focus on Jesus and Mary, but how about Joseph? He never says a word in the Gospels. He's never quoted. He seems like an extra in the narrative, a necessary extra. The Christmas plays, no lines for Joseph. I mean, if there was a Christmas play, would they give him anything to say at all? It reminds me of when I was in elementary school and they gave me a line in a play. And I remember it was some sort of Swiss thing, and I had little shorts and leather shorts and a Swiss thing. And I had one line, and I was so nervous. So I get to say this one line, and everybody else had all the cool stuff. But I was happy. Just one line's enough. I don't need anything else. But it was the most embarrassing thing to wear these little leather shorts. I was probably in about fourth grade, I guess. So who is Joseph? I'm going to just give you a few bullet points. He is the adopting father of Jesus. He is in the royal lineage of David, which was a requirement to be Messiah. He was a tecton, and all of this, many of these things are actually in the text we just read. You think, oh, all this is there, we know about Joseph. So it's amazing how much there is. So he says he was a tecton or a craftsman. He wasn't, a carpenter didn't come in until much later, maybe 300 or 400 years ago, but it was known that he and Jesus, his son, were tectons, meaning they were craftsmen. They were builders. They would use wood, stone, metal, whatever, but it's thought by many scholars that they were mainly working with stone, probably worked in the city of Sephora nearby Nazareth, where there were big stone projects going on. I've actually been to the ruins of Sephora. So Jesus, there are many references in Jesus' writings and his sayings. He didn't write, but in his sayings, many references to buildings and materials. In his parables, that indicate probably more stone than wood. Joseph passed his trade on to Jesus. It's a tradition then that when you're turned 12 years old, you pass the trade on. He was the father of at least 7 children. Remember the pilgrims? You know, we talked about them a few weeks ago, how each one of them that came on the Mayflower, they had an average of 9 kids per couple. Well, it wasn't a lot different then. So they had at least 7 children between Joseph and Mary, James, Joseph, Simon, and Judas, and 2 sisters. He was very young at the time of Jesus' birth. It's thought that Mary and Joseph were probably teenagers. That was typical. It was customary at that time. And so most scholars believe that he and Mary were in their teens, with him being potentially a bit older. Now, not well off. They were not well off, but they were not poor. They were craftsmen, business people. They had the money for an extended stay in the guest house in Bethlehem. Now, remember, it's not that they couldn't afford to get a room. There was no room in the inn. It's not that they couldn't afford to pay for a room. They were all booked up. So later, though, we know the Magi brought gifts of gold and frankincense and myrrh and expensive gifts for a king, appropriate for a king. This must have helped provide for their later extended stay in Egypt as they're escaping Herod. So it's not like they were this poor family. I mean, they stayed in Egypt for 2 years. So and Joseph no doubt restarted his trade there and so forth. But the fact is that they were not poor people. So Jesus would have to, and the other thing that's thought is that Joseph must have died quite young. So Jesus himself would have had to experience the loss of a very loved and respected father. Think about that. You know, we don't hear really anything about that, any of the detail. We don't hear anything from Jesus about his experience in losing his father in the process of grief and all of the things that you go through, but he did. Jesus took over essentially responsibility for the family as the oldest son. So Joseph was chosen. You think of Mary as being chosen, but really Joseph was chosen too when Mary was chosen and when she was told you're going to conceive. So there's three things I want you to know about Joseph, and they're all instructive to us. Joseph was not chosen because he was a leader in Israel or a rabbi or was prominent in Jerusalem. And this is interesting to me because I think a lot of times we can be dismissive of the depth of the work in young adult men and women. These were young adults, and I think it's amazing that God called these young people to carry such a heavy responsibility. And I mean, I think that young people today seem to have a delayed adolescence. They seem to take a long time to grow up and to reach the customary hurdles of adulthood. But in that day and time, and you see it throughout the Bible, you see young people that God would call, and we don't often think of them as young people. And a lot of times when you see movies and things, they portray them, even the disciples, you look at some of the old movies and disciples are like guys in their 30s, in their 40s. And like, you guys are all single in your 30s and 40s? I mean, what's going on here? Well, the reason they were single is they weren't in their 30s and 40s. They were like 19 and 20, you see. And so as a young adult or an older teen, it is remarkable as to how much their inner character and fortitude, Mary and Joseph, was already developed enough to qualify them for this amazing mission. And there are many young people that have amazing things that God wants to do with them that they have to build the fortitude and the character early on to be able to get in the trajectory so God can use them. But never underestimate. If you're here and you're under 25, do not underestimate what God may want to do significantly through you and your life. And so, but allow him to develop that fortitude of character that he had done with Mary and Joseph at such a young age. So the first thing we need to know about Joseph is that he was devoted and he was consistent. Look at this passage in Luke chapter 2. When Joseph and Mary had done everything required by the law of the Lord, they returned to Galilee to their own town of Nazareth. And the child grew and became strong, and he was filled with wisdom, and the grace of God was on him. So that's later in the life of Joseph and Jesus. But what I want you to just get this insight, that these were very devout people, very devout people. And so it says, now his parents, another passage in Luke chapter 2, now his parents went to Jerusalem every year at the Feast of Passover. This was a very extensive commitment. It involved possibly perhaps weeks of their commitment of their time, their finances, and so forth. And so this was a festival. It was a big deal, but they were a part of that. And so these people were very, very committed. They weren't just in theory committed. They weren't just, I have this relationship with God, but it expressed itself in practical ways of devotion. You think that it was, in other words, these are very principle-driven people. Their devotion to God was expressed in their lifestyle choices. And you think of that, you know, today you think, well, if somebody is devoted to God, does it express itself in a practical way? Does it express this devotion, this love for God? And I think we're very lax today. People just think they can float in and out of churches and bounce around and, well, I don't know if I'll serve. And we see kind of churches like a hobby or something. I go and I watch the show and I don't know, maybe I'll go to this church, they have a better show, and maybe I'll go there. We've lost the whole concept of what it means to live a devout life. And so a devout life involves giving to your church, supporting your church. It involves attending and participating. It involves an attitude of service. It involves, in other words, these are devout people, and if you are devout, it must express itself in devotion, right? And so you think, well, that just sounds so mundane. These people were just committed and principle-driven. It sounds mundane. You know what? A lot of life and character building and the fortitude that God wants us to develop in our lives, a lot of it is mundane. But it's that faithfulness, that consistency that's so important. So in Luke chapter 4, it says, he went to Nazareth, where he had been brought up. And on the Sabbath day, he went into the synagogue. This is referring to Jesus. So I want you to catch this. Jesus, that is, went to the Nazareth, where he had been brought up. And on the Sabbath day, he went into the synagogue, as was his custom. You follow? I want you to see reflected, Jesus raised by parents who were very devout, and they lived in a principle-driven fashion, and they loved God intensely, but it surfaced in habits, daily habits, weekly habits, and so forth. And Jesus, as was his custom, meaning that on a weekly basis, he was involved in the synagogue. He stood up to read, and then you can follow that passage. So I have a notable thought for you. Joseph led his family as a spiritual and devout man. God chose Joseph because he would model for Jesus a manhood that reflected his character by joining mercy, humility, and spiritual depth with tough, obedient strength and hard work. That's what I see in Joseph. I see this convergence of these values in Joseph and who he was as a man. And it was in this environment that God placed Jesus to be cultivated for the mission. Number two about Joseph. Joseph was a merciful man. He is a protector. So Mary and Joseph were betrothed or engaged to be married. In this culture, to be betrothed was as binding as actual marriage. You took vows, you exchanged the dowry, and needed a divorce to dissolve this union, even if the couple had not yet been intimate. In other words, presumably they have not been intimate, but there's this promise or intent to marry that's very, very serious, much more serious than what we would see in a contemporary sense of engagement. Engagements are broken all the time in our culture, but this was much more similar to marriage than it was engagement as we know it. So imagine the conversation. Here they are on track to get married, and Mary has to have this conversation. Well, I had this angel appear to me, and it seems that I'm pregnant. And he said, God has conceived this in me. Now you're Joseph. Imagine this conversation. Wouldn't you love it if we could just be a bug on the wall? And we could hear them talking in Aramaic to each other? And we could watch their tone and watch his reactions and his body language. And he tells him, she tells him. And he's thinking, what does this mean? In other words, this is the girl I love. I'm committed to marry her. And she is pregnant by another. This is what I'm saying. Here's this guy, good man. And all of a sudden, he's interjected in the greatest scandal of all time, ever. She has cheated on him. There's betrayal. Plans and dreams are now being destroyed right before his eyes. Everything they hoped for. But he loved Mary so much, but now he's facing this. She's cheated on me. There's no other way that this happens. This is a law of biology. We've known it forever. There's no way around it. Let's just be rational. Let's just be logical. Mary, what are you telling me? What kind of a cover story is this? Can you just be honest with me? This is undeniable. There's no denying the facts here. Mary is pregnant. But Joseph has never touched her. Thus, she apparently had sex with another man. This is a law of biology. It didn't take Louis Pasteur to come up with this one. We've known it was a law of biology before the scientific revolution. Put yourself in his shoes for a moment. How would you feel? Would you feel humiliated? Would you feel angry? Would you feel jealous? I think Joseph probably felt all those things. What was he going to do now? What would you do in his situation? So it says in Matthew chapter 1, it says, because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law and yet did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. So you may look at that passage and think, divorce her quietly? You know, how is that compassionate? You're still gonna dump her. But here, I'm gonna show you a brief clip. It kind of gives you the context for understanding the culture of that day. So follow this.
When a man is betrothed to a woman, if at any time before the wedding feast the bride is discovered to be pregnant, the groom has two options. First, according to the law, he can divorce her publicly, bringing charges against her. If found guilty, she would then be stoned. Or he can divorce her privately. For the remainder of her life, she would then be known as a mother who conceived out of wedlock. Either of these fates is what seemingly awaits young Mary. Amazingly, she humbly agrees to carry the Son of God. When Joseph learns that Mary is with child, he considers divorcing her privately. He too is visited by an angel and told to take Mary as his wife. The story of Jesus' birth is known as one of the greatest stories ever told. However, from Mary's perspective, the story could be described as anything but great. She was a young, recently wed bride, far from home, giving birth in what most likely was a cave. Despite these humble circumstances, she knew the significance of these events and pondered them in her heart.
Okay, so this second thing, second characteristic about Joseph, so he's a merciful man and he is a protector. So he acts to protect Mary and then he obeys the angel that came and advised him. Marry her. Don't dump her. Don't throw her out. Take her under your wing. Protect her. Provide for her. Make her your own. And so he obeyed. And so Joseph truly loved Mary. He stood by her. Even now, he was protecting her. Even in that supposed quiet divorce, all these steps that he was taking were to try to protect her. So the third thing about Joseph is he listens and obeys. We'll start in reading Matthew chapter 1, verses 20 through 25. I'm going to do it in two sections. But when he had considered this, behold, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream, saying, Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child who has been conceived in her is of the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you shall call his name Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins. And then continuing, now, all this took place to fulfill what was spoken by the Lord through the prophet. Behold, the virgin shall be with child and shall bear a son, and they shall call his name Emmanuel, which translated means God with us. And Joseph awoke from his sleep and did as the angel of the Lord commanded him and took Mary as his wife, but kept her a virgin until she gave birth to a son, and he called his name Jesus. Isn't that interesting? So she remained a virgin. She did not remain a virgin perpetually. I know that may be a rude awakening for somebody. It just through this season that, oh my goodness, okay. All right, so the angel intervenes in the nick of time. And I think of all the things Joseph was trying to work through and the doubts he must have had and the inner conflict, trying to figure out what's really real here and what do I believe. Well, the angel came and brought such clarity to him that it was something it was actionable. And it reminds me of the scripture in the New Testament. It says, no temptation will befall you except as common to man, and God will provide the way of escape. In other words, he's not going to put on us more than we're able. And there was a point where Joseph needed more information, and God provided it. God did not tell Joseph until he had to sweat it for a while. Not real long, but he had to sweat it there for a bit. You know, and that's where the story is so intriguing, because we're wondering what was he going through in this process. But once he understands, Joseph is quick to obey. Later on, after the child is born, we have this exchange in Matthew chapter 2. It says, when they had gone, an angel of the Lord appeared to Joseph in a dream. Get up, he said, take the child and his mother and escape to Egypt. Stay there until I tell you, for Herod is going to search for the child to kill him. So he got up, took the child and his mother during the night, and left for Egypt, where he stayed until the death of Herod. And so was fulfilled what the Lord had said through the prophet, out of Egypt I called my son. You notice through these various passages, they're always citing the Old Testament to substantiate this is what God is doing, and it's backed up by the Old Testament prophets. There was no New Testament when this was written. Their entire Bible, the Bible that they read, was the Old Testament. And so the trip to Egypt is an interesting scenario because, first of all, that took money to do. They're going to travel, and they're going to be on the move. It says, and if they were to go to Alexandria, Egypt, or one of the other Greek cities, there were a lot of Jews in Alexandria, probably a million, supposedly. And so, but Alexandria, Egypt, is about 300 miles away. So how did they get there? If they went on foot, like it shows in the picture, that would have perhaps taken, she's got Jesus on her back, and they're walking with all their goods on a burro or a mule. And so how would they have traveled? How did they get to Alexandria? Did they actually travel for a month or 5 weeks or 6 weeks alone on the highways and in the thoroughfares that they were accustomed to traveling? Or could they perhaps have taken a ship? And if they had taken a ship from one of the coastal cities near them, it would have taken just a few days to get there. And so I suspect that they very likely may have taken a ship and traveled to Alexandria or one of the areas in that part of Egypt. That just, to me, makes a lot more sense. And they had the means. They had the money. Remember, the Magi had come and brought them gold and frankincense and all these expensive spices. They had money. They had the means. And God had already pre-prepared. He had prepared the way for them to have all the provision they needed to be able to make this move to Egypt. So picture this. After being traumatized by an out-of-wedlock pregnancy, in obedience to God, Joseph accepted Mary as his wife while foregoing marital privileges until after the birth of the baby that was not his. He raised Jesus as his very own. He had to flee all the way to Egypt for an extended stay and then move back again to Nazareth. There's no record of a complaint from Joseph. I already mentioned, there's no record of Joseph ever saying anything. So, I mean, it'd be unfortunate if all we heard was a complaining. But there's no record of a complaint. He willingly gave up his rights, his demands, his needs in order to serve God's purposes and the needs of his new family. If Joseph could speak to us, maybe this is what he would have said. I love Michael Card's song. I think it's unique because it's focusing on Joseph's life rather than a traditional approach. And in the song that we heard prior to the message, he says this. He says, how could it be this baby in my arms sleeping now so peacefully? The Son of God, the angel said, how could it be? Lord, I know he's not my own, not of my flesh, not of my bone. Still, Father, let this baby be the son of my love. Father, show me where I fit into this plan of yours. How can a man be a father to the Son of God? Lord, for all my life I've been a simple carpenter or tecton. How can I raise a king? How can I raise a king? He looks so small, his face and hands so fair. And when he cries, the sun just seems to disappear, but when he laughs, it shines again. How could it be? So a couple of things I want to conclude with in this story. Being in the center of God's will, which Joseph was, is not without its challenges and risks. No matter how we navigate through life, there's going to be challenges. Now, obviously, there's a lot of things we bring on ourselves because of our own stubbornness, and sinful choices have consequences. Obviously, the many, many things that we all deal that are direct consequences of just unwise decisions. But that's not what we're dealing with here. We're dealing with a man who is in the center of God's will, and as far as we know, always obeyed. And being in the center of God's will is not without its challenges and risks. Are our expectations of what living by faith is sometimes unrealistic? That would be my question. You know, I think, why didn't God just kill Herod? You ever think of that? I mean, there's this kind of interventional theory. You could say, well, if God had done this, they wouldn't have had to do this. But if God had done that, you know, what I've noticed in the scriptures, God doesn't really relish a lot of shortcuts. He's not necessarily trying to make it, oh, well, we'll just make this as easy as pie. We'll just take out Herod and they won't even have to go to Egypt and we wouldn't have to do the whole angelic thing and all that. We just live happily ever after. But it seems that in life, even in the center of God's will, that often there is a struggle. There are challenges along the way, and God really is not a micromanager. He's involved, and he's leading us and speaking with us and guiding us, but he's not. And you see it even in this story. You don't see God as some sort of a grand puppeteer in the sky micromanaging everything. Their lives were at risk, so we're going to run for our life. And I'm going to help you, and this is what you're going to do, and I already provided the money for you to do it. Why didn't he have the angels reveal the birth to the Jewish religious leadership at the temple? Why did he reveal the birth to a bunch of shepherds? Why was it all done in such obscurity? Couldn't we have come in with a greater splash? Why didn't God plan ahead and reserve a decent room for them to have a baby? Couldn't God have provided a better conditions instead of in a stall or in a cave or whatever where cows were? In other words, this is life. And God doesn't necessarily go to great lengths to make sure our life is just this pathway sprinkled with rose petals. We learn to cope, we learn to adapt, we learn to listen, we learn to obey, and we learn to follow Him, and we learn to be faithful regardless, just like Joseph and Mary were. And we too, according to Scripture, we have been chosen in Him. We have a duty, we have a mission. We are commissioned with a job to do. We're carrying the light like we were talking about with our candles. We are the light of the world. We're extending the light of Jesus. Like Joseph, may we live our lives with integrity and devotion, obeying His word and trust God even when it's difficult and hard to understand. Do you get that? Let's stand together. Jaron, do y'all have maybe another, did you have another Christmas carol kind of in the bag, or? So something maybe we could close out with. The children's ministry only have like 30 minutes. Take a few more minutes. Thank you. Whatever you think. Y'all want to hear everything, the secret conversation? Didn't you always wonder what they're saying on stage? Here, listen to what she's saying. We're exchanging our diseases, you see. Whatever you think. Maybe she'd do candles again. No, I'm just kidding. I like the fire. She'd do it all the time. You know, as we sing this, I just want to challenge us that as we're challenged by Joseph and Mary as young people and how devout they were and how committed they were and how deeply they loved God, and perhaps you've kind of wondered. Maybe your focus has been off. Maybe, you know, I just want us to have a resolve right now while whatever she chooses to do, whatever she decides to do, that we'll just go with it. But just to offer your heart. We're coming on a new year. And Lord, I want to be faithful. I want to do devout. I want to live my life. I want to live my life in a way that represents you well. I want to love the work of God. I want to love His church. I want to love the people of God. I want to care about the world around me, right? So easy just to get so preoccupied in all of our own issues and minutiae of daily life.
Jesus, name above every other name.
Yes, Lord. Yes. amen. I want to encourage you, just if you have kids and net kids, just perhaps give them another 5 or 7 or 8 minutes to finish up their program this morning. And that would be helpful. Just hang out, connect, give somebody a hug, you know, inflame our germ pool. And Lord bless you guys. Have a great week, great afternoon.